Welcome to the next lesson. In this part, we are going to learn how to create simple beam definition following the six basic steps I showed you in the previous recording. Please, let's start from changing the units in the Rhino viewport settings. So right-click on the millimeters and click Unit Settings. During Karamba installation, we choose to use SI system of the units, and meters are the default unit that Karamba understands. So please choose here from the drop-down menu meters and approve clicking OK. So now we are working with meters. So starting from scratch, we need to define 3 points that gonna create our wireframe geometry used for the Karamba. Please construct the point. I'm pretty bad in typing, as I see. So you could just type it better than me, or you could also find it under vector, point, and construct point. Please copy this component 2 times. So in total, we have 3 construct point components. I could just slightly adjust them to make them nicer. And they appeared in our Rhino viewport as 1 point just in the middle of the coordinate system. Please move the first one by 1 meter in X direction and 1 meter into Y direction. It is just to move this point slightly from the center of coordinate system to see it better. The first point we move just to see it better in the coordinate system. And the second point, please move by 5 meters into X direction. And the last point, please move by 5 meters into Y direction, just by simply plugging 5 to the Y input. So now we have these 3 points. And let's merge them into one list using the merge component. Start not from the middle one, but one of the edge points as the first input to the merge. In this way, I have the list of 3 points. Now I could create my wireframe geometry. And to do this, I could just use polyline. So if I plug in my 3 points that are in specific order, I have my polyline constructed. And theoretically, I should be able to convert it into the beam element. And we could do this using line to beam. And let's try to plug just polyline into line. We have no error and everything seems to work fine. But this is not the right move, because as the component specifies, we should give the line as an input. But let's check it out how Karamba understood this polyline, how it was converted into beam. To see it right now, we need to assemble the statical model. This is the 4th step of our whole definition for Karamba workflow, but we could assemble model in any time. So please do it now. Just type assemble model Karamba, or of course you could also find it under Karamba components panel, choosing model, and assemble model is the 2nd on the list. So basically, if I now plug in my element to element, my model is assembled. Okay, I have no supports and no loads, but the beams are ready. So now I could also see my model, yes? Let's use one of the views components to see the beam. Beam view. And now if I connect model to model, I should be able to see something. And here we go. That's my beam that was created using the polyline. Obviously, this is not something we wanted to have, as we wanted to have 2 beams connected in this point. So that is why, like, you could plug in polylines, but this is not the right way to construct the statical model. So let's change it now into lines using explode. So basically, the polyline is going to be exploded into line pieces. And as you see, this is the difference. So now I have two lines and I have two beams in my Karamba definition. Sometimes if you don't know if your elements are lines, just to be sure that everything is fine, you could plug in this default line component that checks if lines after explosion are real lines. Okay, just to be sure. So it looks that I have already two beams and I could even see them. So the second step in creation of the Karamba statical model was defining the supports. Again, we could just type support, and as you see, we have support Karamba here. Or we could find this under a model and support Karamba. What I need to plug in here as an input is the position or index of the support points. So basically, if this is my two beams, those are my two beams, and I would like to support them at the end and have some load here. We could do this in two ways. I could plug in the external points. It's this one and the last one. Okay, and I want to have them connected rigidly to the ground. So basic plan is XY. So they're going to be connected to the ground, sort of. And I could block the degree of freedom in any direction of translation and rotational degree of freedom. And now, okay, if I plug it to assemble, so now my statical model has already beams and supports, but I would like to see the supports, if I define the position of the supports correctly. In order to do this, we need to use the second view component that is called model view and is used almost in every situation. Again, let's plug in the model to model. And this component allows me to visualize the statical situation and change the basic scale of what I can see. So basically, I could also make my supports here slightly bigger if you cannot see them properly. And as you see, the degree of freedom that are blocked that are properly displayed. So for example, if I now unblock one of the axes, you could see this in the model. Okay, let's go further. So we have beams, we have support. Now it's time to define the load. Please choose the load from the Karamba's components panel. Just choose loads component. And this is a multiple component that could change its inputs depending on the type of the load you define. So please choose the point load. And we're going to specify load acting vertically down at this point of our two beams. So we need to specify first of all the vector direction actually of the force action, that is vertical direction, and now we need to specify again direction, but I mean plus or minus, so down or up, yes, in this sense direction. And let's make it acting down. Then we could also specify the moment and specify if the load should rotate if the node, if we use the deformation analysis, but this is not important right in this small example. For us, what's important now is to define the position where the load acts. And this is the middle point of those three points. And this is this one. And I could specify it by just grabbing this point to the point, but also, if you see, this point is a second on my list of points. Also here, I could just say that this is the index number one and should be no difference in the selection of the point. Let's check it out if there is no difference, because I can't see any load so far. So let's plug in load to the load. And as you see, my small load appeared here. I could just change slightly the scale to see it better. And let's have a look if there is any difference if I plug in the point back or I plug in the index number. There is no difference, so it works perfectly fine with both cases. So now it was optional so far, but let's specify the cross section and material for our beams. So first of all, cross section. Let's choose the cross section range selector, please. That could be also found here on the cross section panel, and it's cross section range selector Karamba. And then we could specify from the library of the Karamba's cross section for what cross section we are looking for. And let's choose EU, shape I, and family HEA. Okay. So this is our family of cross sections. And if you plug in panel to the output of this component, you could see how many cross sections of this type. There is on a list 24 of them, actually. Okay, let's keep an eye on them. And now we need to specify which one of those we would like to use. So, selector, cross-section, selector we need now. And basically, I could say, okay, take one cross-section from this list. And again, I could give a name, one of these names that are specified in the panel, or just say which index from the list I would like to choose. As I have 24 elements, I could specify a slider from 0 to 23. Let's select these elements. When I plug into the name, it automatically changes the name to the name or list index of cross-section. And please plug in this cross-section to the cross-section into assemble component. So now, if I change cross section, I could see it. Okay, so basically we are choosing the elements from this list. And now let's also specify material. And again, we could just use material selection and use predefined materials that are already installed when you installed Karamba. So family steel and basic steel S235. And let's plug in this to the material into assemble component. I will zoom out for a second. So as you see, we created here our geometry, converted it into beams. Then we specified supports, we specified load, and we specified cross section and material. So our assemble model is a full statical model ready for calculation. Right now we have done no calculation, we just displayed the statical model using the two view components, that is beam view and model view. Now let's please calculate the statical model. Let's go to algorithms and use analyze theory 1. It calculates deflections using first order theory. The second order theory is used quite rarely in practice and mostly when we consider buckling modes for the structure. In most of the cases, we just use analyze theory 1. Let's plug in. And as output, we have the maximum displacement that is very, very small. It's given in meters, so it's below 1 centimeter. We have the resulting force of gravity that is 0 right now, and elastic energy there is some. Okay, so now please plug the model after analyze to the model view and beam view. So basically, it's gonna show us the deformation on the real model. If I zoom in, the deformation now is really, really tiny. Because the beam is really stiff, I will just make a smaller beam, okay? So now my deformation is slightly bigger. So, if we consider this, okay, as you see, it shows the deformation, but it shows only on the line. If we wanna see it on a beam, because now the beam view displays our cross section, please plug in the beam view after the model view. So it adjusts to this, and I could see perfectly my deflection now. Okay? Basically, you could use these models in any configuration, but you could display model before analyze and after analyze. depends what you would like to see. If I want to see my beams deflecting, this is the right configuration. So the formation that goes, so one is like real deformation that is almost nothing. And then this is like exaggeration, how many times we exaggerate the deformation of the structure. So what we could also see using this as our results, first of all, we have this deformation. We could see the reactions on the supports. We could also see local axis of the beams, if they are rotated or not. Then render settings, upper results, lower, so absolute value or adjusted percentage of it. Then we have also tags. I could see which node has which index. Sometimes it's very useful. We could see the elements, which one is on list, which one, and IDs. I have no ID because I didn't plug in any name, but I could see the cross-section names that are used for beam and material used for beam. And load values. And here we have load case selection. Right now we have all load cases selected. Okay, so now I will explain you why do we need to use the load cases. So basically, if we need gravity, and this is actually we always need gravity that acts on the whole model. Let's add it right now by dragging the gravity load component. As a default, it works down and it's like dead load of our structure. And now, as you see, the point load has L case equal to zero and gravity has L case also equal to zero. I will give another number. I will give L case equal 1 for gravity. And let's plug in this load to the loads in the assemble component and keep an eye on having flattened list of the loads. So let's go now to the model view component and to the last submenu that is called load case selection. Now I have a choice which load case I would like to see in the deformation. So now, if I have all, it means it considers both my gravity and the point load. Now, if I select just zero, it considers just my point load. And if I select my load case number 1, it selects just gravity. So this is the difference. And basically, you could specify different load cases for different scenarios and then display them as you wish and calculate them as you wish using load cases selection. So here on the beam view, we could also display like our displacement and to see what these colors actually mean. Let's put a legend, this default grasshopper component, and let's plug legend C to C and legend T to T and see what does it mean. And it displays in centimeters. Always pay attention to the units. This is in centimeters, so the more pink, the more displaced is the node. And displacement is measured not only in the nodes, but also in the middle of elements. We could also display utilization to see how the model is utilized. And of course, where is tensioned and where is like compressed using the red and blue colors. And usually the convention is that they could be utilized to almost 90% of their utilization factor. So right now we are in pretty safe situation. And that would be it for this lesson. We created first statical model of two beams that are rigidly connected. We could display the deformation. We could see the displacement and utilization of the elements. So thank you and see you in the next one.